Good morning to you all. Good morning. Morning. Are we feeling happy? Yeah. Are we feeling like we are not in your typical academic conference?
Yeah. It's a win, right? It's a win.
So thank you so much for your cheers a few minutes ago. And I'm just quickly going to introduce people that you already know, so it's kind of a lame job, you know. But to my right side, we have world-renowned Meg John Barker, polyamory expert. And even further to my right, but moving, we have Ana Cristina Santos, also internationally renowned sociologist from the University of Coimbra, whereas Meg John Barker hails from the Open University, right? I got that right, okay. So I'm not here actually doing anything, so I'm just gonna let them do the talking because you came for them. So please enjoy, thank you so much.
Thank you. Can I get my presentation up? Yeah, brilliant. So can you hear me okay? Yeah, awesome. I'm a little bit dizzy this morning. I think I have some ear problems, so I'm gonna sit down, so I hope that's all right. It's kind of reclining up here. Brilliant, thank you so much. So Daniel asked me to do quite a general introduction about kind of my sense of where we are at the moment. So I think some of this will be familiar to most of you, but hopefully it helps to tease together the kind of threads of the research, the academic work in this area, also the therapeutic stuff in this area, and also the activist stuff in this area, because I very much regard myself as going across all three of those things. So for those who don't know who I am, I'm a senior lecturer at the Open University in the UK, but I'm also a therapist specializing in gender and sexual diversity. And actually the thing that I'm most excited about really is the activism and the writing I do. So mostly I write for a general audience. A few years back, I wrote a book called Rewriting the Rules, which is kind of like an anti-self-help book is what I called it, because it's about seeing the social rules and norms as the problem rather than the individual person. So instead of like change yourself, it's like let's change the world, which I think is more what needs to change. At the moment, I'm working on another book aimed at a general audience based on the Enduring Love Project about long-term relationships that's been happening in the UK. And I'm also working on a comic book introduction to queer theory. How exciting is that? So that's the kind of thing that I really love doing. So this is quite a general overview and introduction. So what I'm gonna do, it's called like non/monogamies, because I think the main thing I'm gonna argue is that the distinction between monogamy and non-monogamy is getting increasingly blurry. And that's one reason why the second part of the title of this conference on contemporary intimacies is really important, because, you know, can we just talk about non-monogamy anymore? I'm not sure that we can. So in terms of the structure, I'm going to go through this. I'm going to start with where we were 10 years ago, because 10 years ago we had the first European conference on this topic in Hamburg. And I know there's at least one other person who was at that conference besides me. Anyone else? Just us two. So like we're carrying the flag from that conference to this one, which is great. So I'm really thinking like, where have we come since then? Because a lot was happening back in 2005, but I think things have changed quite a lot since then. So I'm gonna talk about that and really talk about, instead of focusing on like there's monogamy, there's non-monogamy, what are they? Which is kind of where we were back then. It's much more about what kind of questions should we be asking maybe about all relationships? Regardless of whether they're monogamous, non-monogamous, or somewhere in the blurry middle ground. And I'm gonna end up with some questions I've been asking most recently about the idea of openness and open relationships, and whether if we thought about the word open in different ways, maybe again, we'd be asking some slightly different questions, which I think will lead on quite nicely into some of the other presentations that you're gonna be hearing over the next few days. Okay, so. 2005, where were we at? So this is broadly the idea of the split, and I think it felt like to me like when people were starting to do this this academic work around non-monogamous relationships. Wider culture very much saw it in this way, and the first kind of academic work that was happening very much was focusing on it in this quite divided way. So we had the kind of ideals of monogamy. And if you're familiar, I actually tweeted yesterday the abstracts from that conference back in 2005, and it was called a conference on polyamory and mononormativity. And I think Marianne Piper and Robin Bauer, who ran that conference, coined that term mononormativity, which was basically this idea that there's a complete kind of idea that monogamy is the normal and natural thing that everyone should be aspiring to. And certainly back then, generally, what we saw in terms of representations was also a very heteronormative and mononormative model. So we've also seen all of the shifts in terms of acceptance of same-sex relationships, same-sex marriage since then as well. And these little cartoons I did for an event called Poly Day, which we had, I think, the first one around that time as well. And they kind of illustrate the different forms of non-monogamy that we were talking about back then. So it was generally these three, I think. So we were talking about swinging and open relationships, which were broadly about relationships where there was a primary romantic relationship and people were having some kind of sexual relationships outside of that. And then we were talking about polyamory. And polyamory was really a burgeoning community at this time, particularly around, on the internet, people were getting to know other people. And certainly in London, where I was, there was a real kind of burgeoning polyamorous community, polyactivism. We were starting having events like Poly Day. And that was about having multiple love relationships, broadly speaking. So they might be sexual, there's certainly love relationships. And of course, even back then, this model of kind of majority monogamy, minority open non-monogamy wasn't accurate to what people were actually doing. So that was around that time the statistics were coming out for secret non-monogamy or infidelities or affairs, up to about 50% to even up to 2/3 of people in married and monogamous relationships in the West having secret non-monogamy. So it wasn't, that was already, that boundary was being blurred. And then of course, globally, I think I remember the statistic at the time being that the more countries globally were non-monogamous, openly non-monogamous than were monogamous. So again, this kind of Western fixation on open non-monogamy as a really new thing and a really minority thing didn't fit that. And because we're in multicultural societies, a lot of people's backgrounds were actually in non-monogamous and openly non-monogamous arrangements. Very few people were writing about that, apart from Nathan over here, who we're going to hear from in another keynote. So it's going to be really useful, I think, to touch in on where that kind of research is at. So the non-monogamy-monogamy split wasn't really even working back then, but it was generally how things were seen, I think, particularly in wider culture, with non-monogamy generally being represented in the media as kind of either threatening and dangerous or freaky and weird. And I had my own taste of this in 2005 because I did a conference early that year and the newspapers picked up on it. and it ended up being basically the week's news. If the Pope hadn't died that week, then it would have been even worse, but believe me, it was bad enough. My favourite headline, bisexual boffin, I am a slut. Yeah. I was that bisexual boffin. But this was on the back of doing an academic paper about polyamory and just being open about the fact I was polyamorous. I don't think that would happen today. I think that is one sign of how far things have moved on. I don't think that the media would cover it in anything like that way or even be as excited about the topic in that kind of salacious manner. So, things have really moved on. Where are we at in 2015? I think that sort of both monogamy and non-monogamy have kind of expanded, and I think it's quite similar to the shifts we've seen around gender and sexuality. So obviously something else I write about a lot is non-binary gender, and you might be familiar with kind of Facebook and how there's now maybe around 60 different words on Facebook that a person can choose for their gender. Also, the kind of words for sexual identities have expanded a great deal. There's many more words that people are using to describe their sexuality. And we got really Happily, we've got a couple of panels at this conference on asexuality, and I know that people are doing research in that area. You know, again, there's multiple words that are coming up to describe different forms of asexuality or aromanticism. So we see this kind of proliferation of terms across multiple areas, and I would just point to the fact that's what's happening with monogamy and non-monogamy as well. So we've seen the expansion of monogamy into, like, there's monogamish from Dan Savage, there's the new monogamy, there's fuck buddies, hookup culture, friends with benefits. There's various sort of varieties of non-monogamy that are challenging some of the assumptions about what a monogamous relationship looks like. So, for example, the people who live apart together and live in different houses is something that's proliferated quite a bit, and there's been academic studies on that. And then from the non-monogamy side, again, we've seen an expansion of different kinds of swinging, different kinds of open relationships, different kinds of poly. And so just to flag up some, like, the solo poly movement is something we'll hear a bit about over the next few days, relationship anarchy as well. So there's been a real expansion of different understanding of different versions, even of each of the different kinds of open non-monogamy, and the addition of further forms of open non-monogamy as well. And there's been a few other attempts to kind of visually depict this, so people may well be familiar with this one. The marvellous Franklin Vo, who I'm going to mention several times, I think, in this presentation. And you won't be able to read much of that, but it's available on the internet. but I'll just draw your attention to this kind of area here, which really gets at this sort of fact that the monogamy and non-monogamy boundary is much blurrier. There's some forms of open non-monogamy that actually more restrictive than some forms of monogamy, for example. And in this kind of area, it's really kind of blurring the boundaries between the two. Kate Frank, who was a contributor to the book that we did in 2010, me and my colleague Darren Langridge, called Understanding Non-Monogamies, one of the things that she was finding in her anthropological work was that people in monogamous and non-monogamous relationships were having really similar kinds of conversations about their relationships. So she's one of the first people I remember reading who was saying, hang on a minute, you know, how are we distinguishing between the monogamy and the non-monogamy? And particularly around issues of the tension between wanting to be free and independent and wanting to be belonging and in a relationship. That tension was playing out across all of those different kinds of relationships. And I think that, you know, something that's happening in this diagram is to also point out that overlap. Another thing we might be familiar with here, people seen this, this comic is so helpful. So in my relationship therapy work, I often use this comic because I think it really helps to get at that, again, that idea that there are proliferating different forms of open non-monogamy. So I find that with clients who are new to this, they think, you know, there is monogamy and there's open non-monogamy. If we do open non-monogamy, it means we're going to do this, and we probably must be doing it for the same reasons as each other. So it's kind of simple. And this is getting, you know, it really it isn't, because there's so many different forms and they're done in quite different ways and often for quite different reasons. So particularly around, I think, the distinction between the hierarchical polyamory and egalitarian polyamory is a really useful one in this sense of whether it's kind of the primary secondary model that quite a lot of people have written about, or whether it's more a model where people are treated equally. And what does that look like? And what are we talking about? Are we talking about equally in terms of time or in terms of emotional closeness? That kind of thing. And again, we see solo poly and relationship anarchy now finding their way onto depictions like this. And research on monogamy has found a similar thing, that young people who say they're monogamous will assume that that means they have the same meaning about monogamy, that it means the same thing to both of them. And then the research found that after a while, often they would trip over something where actually they had very different understandings, often around things like being friends with an ex-partner or looking at porn online. So for some people, that would be seen as cheating, and for other people, absolutely not. And the research I'm talking about sort of found that was often a reason for breakup. And I think a similar thing in poly, certainly with the poly clients I work with, it's often those kind of things that are tripping people up. okay, so we're both poly, that must mean we want the same things, we're doing it for the same reasons. And then you find actually for one person it was all about being able to have sex outside the relationship, for the other person it was about having multiple emotionally close bonds, and that is causing a real kind of tension when somebody gets into a relationship that the other was like, well, this isn't what I had in mind at all, and I'm finding it really threatening. So a lot of the work I do with clients is about kind of really figuring out what they're wanting and why they're wanting it, and then having that conversation with each other. So if we're moving away from this monogamy, non-monogamy split, really I'm interested in what kind of questions could people be asking about their relationships to clarify really where they're at and to have those kinds of conversations. So again, I'm really interested in quite a practical matter of how we talk about these things. And this is something that I came up with for the book Rewriting the Rules, which some people seem to have found quite useful, again, when I'm working with them therapeutically. And it's important to say that a lot of these ideas have developed within openly non-monogamous communities, within poly communities and relationship anarchy. And I think, as a researcher, I've noticed, particularly in my discipline of psychology, that often psychologists are interested in asking the question of kind of, how do we explain these strange people who are doing this non-normative thing? You know, that's often the question. And even now, I was just recently asked to contribute to a sexuality collection on non-monogamy. I was to be writing a piece on non-monogamy. And they wanted me to speak about how do non-monogamous people differ from monogamous people, like in terms of personality, et cetera. You know, why do they do it? Why do they do it? You know, and how is it for the kids? You know, and it was like just the framing of those questions, right? You know, that there are these two things and it's about comparing the non-normative thing to the normative thing. And I replied kind of saying, look, you need to think about the, I'm not going to do it, and you need to think about the framing of these questions because it's really problematic. So my question is, has always been like, what can everyone learn that's useful for everyone from the people who are kind of at the edge on these things and really having to think about it? And this is one of the things I came up with, was kind of thinking about things on a continuum, which again is an imperfect model, but people find it quite helpful. So instead of thinking, am I monogamous or non-monogamous, we kind of divide it up into the emotional closeness aspect and the sex aspect, and think about where would you be on a preference from having one really close intimate relationship that's relatively fidelitous, I suppose, in terms of emotional closeness, to having multiple close relationships, and also where would you situate yourself on a continuum from having one sexual or physically close relationship and very little sexual or physical closeness outside that relationship to multiple sexual encounters, and getting just people to think about where they might locate themselves on there, where they would like to be on there, where they think their partner is on there, is a useful kind of starting point for some of these conversations. And of course, people start to question those. They're kind of like, well, the first one, is that about romantic love or is it about friendship love? And you get some really interesting conversations then about do those things differ and how do they differ? And some people are like, well, I can't separate the two. For me, they're completely, you know, they come to compete together. And then maybe the other person saying, well, for me, they're really separate. And it just leads into a useful, so I'm not saying these are a perfect model, but they're a useful set of questions that can follow from playing around with these. Then kind of coming to what's come out of the literature so far, another sort of set of useful questions to start asking around contracts and self-disclosure. So if you think about the work of people like Barry Adams and Cassia Wasik-Currier, they've both really focused on the kind of contracts that people have in relationships. And again, of course, we're quite used to the sense of contracts in monogamous relationships around marriage contracts and such like, but also a lot of non-monogamous people go for a contracts-based model. And perhaps this is one of the clearest ways of distinguishing the hierarchical versus egalitarian poly, because often the hierarchical poly is quite contract-based, whereas the egalitarian might be much more about negotiation, trust, communication, and change over time. And then the temporal element comes in here, you know, how a relationship seen as something quite static that we could have a contract for that stayed relatively stable, or are we thinking about having a contract that shifts over time, or is part of the reason we don't want a contract because we recognize inevitability of change over time. And I think it's interesting to bring in that freedom and safety tension there. So people, whether people are kind of focusing on wanting the freedom, the independence, the autonomy end of the scale, or more the security, safety, belonging end of the scale, and how does that map onto contracts? And again, it's not that simple, because Mark Finn's research found that some people felt more free if they had a contract, freedom of contract, and some people felt more free if they didn't have a contract, and similar with safety. You know, maybe it's quite obvious how you might feel safe with a contract, but some people felt really unsafe with a contract because it would be so easy to break it. It felt much more safe to be at the non-contract end of that spectrum. And then again, there's another spectrum in terms of disclosure from, like, at one end, don't ask, don't tell kind of arrangements. We want people to be able to do what they do and not talk about it, to other people being at the tell me everything. Or even in, I think, Barry Adams' research, three-way or no-way was one of the kind of contract ideas that came up, of like you had to actually be together if you were going to do anything with anybody else. And again, different people having different preferences and different relationships on this. And the fact that it's so easy to prioritise primary relationships on this kind of thing. So it might be that, in terms of disclosure, the primary relationship has a clear contract around a disclosure, like, you know, we don't tell people about the other people about the stuff we do. But the arrangement is that if somebody does anything with a secondary partner, they wouldn't get that kind of privacy and there would be disclosure. And this leads into some really interesting stuff that I think Franklin Vo has been writing about in More Than Two and in his recent memoir about this primary, secondary, you know, who's privileged in those kind of hierarchical poly setups. And I wrote a chapter recently about Simone de Beauvoir and Jean-Paul Sartre's relationship, and I found this fascinating quote from Simone de Beauvoir at the end of her life, which was basically saying, you know, we had this great relationship, but one thing we didn't really think about was how much we were objectifying the secondary people, effectively. And it was so interesting that they had almost tried all of the different models of open relationships that were on that first slide over the course of their life. And that was something that she'd really noticed by the end of it, was it's so easy to end up objectifying people, not giving secondaries effectively the same rights as primaries. Another couple of useful ideas, I think, for people to explore, again, in all kinds of relationships, is their preferences around entwinedness and around the relationship escalator. And I think solo poly has really begun to ask these questions about entwinedness. How enmeshed, entwined, or entangled do you want to be in your relationships with other people? How much of an I, how much of a we? And emotionally and practically. So emotionally is things about how much you let people in, I guess, to your feelings, how open you are with people. Practically is like, do you want to live with people? Do you want to share finances? Do you want to keep those kind of things more separate? Again, relevant to all kinds of relationships. And relationship escalator, I certainly got from reading online materials about relationship anarchy and solo poly. This assumption, cultural assumption, that relationships should get emotionally and physically closer over time, and it should only go in this one direction of up, and it's not okay to kind of level out or even go down the escalator. And of course, the Enduring Love Project that I was talking about, which is mostly on monogamous people with some non-monogamous people in there, found that so many people find it useful to level out on their relationship, or even go like down the escalator, like start to do things a bit more separately, or even decide to live separately, that kind of thing. And that can be really helpful for relationships. And the model of it just going up is causes an awful lot of pain, really, especially when people break up and there are all kinds of rules about, you know, don't stay in touch and they're the bad guy and all of this kind of thing, which makes it very hard for people to continue a friend's relationship or a co-parenting relationship. But I guess probably the biggest problem that everyone faces, whether they're monogamous or non-monogamous, single or coupled, sexual or asexual, is mononormativity. So this idea that was coined at the conference 10 years ago. The fact that the everyday world that we inhabit assumes monogamy is the only natural, normal way to do things. And I really found this in the most recent project I've been involved with research-wise has been on sex advice books, like sex manuals, and while also looking at online sex advice and TV programs. And what I really noticed was there's a kind of fundamental set of assumptions behind most sex advice, which frames the problem as sex in long-term relationships. That is the problem it's sex advice is trying to solve, and almost like selling itself on the basis of that being a problem. And of course, that's only a problem if you assume, first of all, that people have to be sexual. So it really speaks to the asexuality research. And secondly, that they have to be monogamous. And thirdly, there is a big assumption that sex equals penis and vagina intercourse and pretty much nothing else. And those three assumptions are the founding basis. And so if you look at sex manuals, like so few of them consider any form of non-monogamy. And they really tie themselves up in knots trying to deal with the possibility of open non-monogamy. And I think some people may have heard, but my favorite example is like a lot of the books know that a big common fantasy is a threesome. So they have to like deal with the fact that people have this big fantasy about having a threesome, but of course they mustn't stray outside of the monogamous couple. So that they claim that as good as having a threesome is to have sex in front of the mirror. That's the way to do it. Because it's just the same. It's actually four people, technically. And two of them are you, but in reverse. But yeah. No, totally a valid sexual thing to do, but not quite the same as a threesome, I would argue. But I mean, I think reading those books just really brought home even how fundamental this mononormative assumption is. And that means that people who are secretly or openly non-monogamous have to decide constantly whether to come out or remain closeted, and the stress that happens on either side of that. If you come out, it's the alienation, the rejection, the questioning, the pressure to be the kind of poster child for it, and you know, in a similar way to people with same-sex relationships, and also the lack of legal protection, and particularly for people with kids, the kind of constant questioning about that, which seems to be really, really big still. And luckily, we've got Maria's work, who's here, and Elizabeth Sheff's work now, that gives us some clout when we're kind of trying to say, actually, kids from poly relationships and openly non-monogamous relationships do just fine, but still there is very a lack of legal protection for those kind of families. Oh yeah, I just wanted to zoom in on. So in terms of the impact of mononormativity, I'm sure a lot of people have seen this, but the kind of stereotypes that are still abound about polyamory. And that, yeah, definitely my research suggests that is the main thing that we really do. Time management. So I think the second biggest problem that openly non-monogamous people face is polynormativity. And this is one of the great things that has been written about in the last 10 years. I don't remember this being a term at the Hamburg conference, but it certainly is now. It's something I've written about with Eleanor Wilkinson and Jamie Hecker, but I know there's other people like Elizabeth Sheff writing about the same thing. And it's how, you know, if you're outside of the mononormative model, you're in a very precarious place, and it's very easy to grasp onto another normativity. And the reason there's a bucket of crabs in the middle there is that's the analogy I use for this, which comes from Terry Pratchett, much missed Terry Pratchett, who in one of his books describes the crab bucket as a metaphor for how social norms keep us trapped. So in a bucket of crabs, if a crab tries to get out of the bucket, the other crabs pull it back in, and it also kind of wants to be in the bucket. It's kind of safe in there. And I was imagining, well, what if a crab gets out of the mononormative crab bucket? Well, it's running around on the beach. It's a really scary place to be. A seagull might get you, that kind of thing. So you go to the next bucket and you get in that one, and there's polynormativity. And again, you don't even realize you're in the bucket. Maybe you're looking at the other bucket thinking, ha ha, mononormativity. But you're in a bucket. And at OpenCon a couple of years ago, OpenCon event in the UK, I asked people to think about, well, what's the poly crab bucket? And they came up with two. It's like, there's the real contracts rules kind of crab bucket for poly, but there's also a real kind of, everyone must be free, no one must feel jealous, you know, right? Yeah, so it's so easy to find yourself in there and kind of struggling with that. So the other things I kind of think are key elements of polynormativity are like the shift from looking for the one true partner to looking for the one true way of doing relationships that's going to make everything safe. And I call that the search for the poly grail. But again, I think, yeah. Oh, booing, really? I know it's a bad pun. But I think it's a real temptation to think, okay, I can't find a perfect person who's going to make everything okay, but if I can just find the right way of doing relationships or the unicorn poly kind of model, if I can just find that hot boy babe who's going to love us both or whatever, it's that'll make everything safe and everything okay. And of course, you know, intimate relationships just don't work that way. They're always going to be tough. I think there is always that kind of hope that somewhere there will be a version that won't be difficult, but it will always be difficult. And yeah, so you get kind of further exclusions. You get the kind of these kind of dividing lines between the good version, you know, of poly and the bad version, or poly's better than swinging, or swinging's better than poly, and all that kind of nonsense. Yeah. So I think linked to mononormativity is language, and just to touch on this. This was actually the paper that I presented at that 2005 conference with Annie Ritchie, which was called, it was published in the Sexualities Journal. There aren't words for what we do or how we feel, so we have to make them up. And I do think a really interesting thing about open non-monogamy has been that kind of coming up with new words to describe experiences and also to kind of enable experiences, that once you kind of have some language for talking about something, maybe you can have experiences that you couldn't otherwise have. So we were looking at words for identity, like poly and monogamish and ethical slut, but also words for different kinds of relationship, like primary, secondary, metamore for partners, other partner, triad, polycule is another one that we're hearing a lot about in the new collection that Elizabeth Sheff put together about stories from the polycule. And then words for emotions, like words for small versions of jealousy. So like we could expand out the understanding of jealousy so it wasn't just this one thing that was a kind of natural response that meant the other person had to stop what they were doing, but there could be little jealousy moments, like I think wibble and wobble were words, particularly I think the ethical slut used wobble for a small jealousy. And then obviously the opposite of jealousy, the words like compersion and frubbly, which is the UK version of compersion. Yeah. My friend made it up as a joke and then it stuck, unfortunately. He's not too happy about it, but. And then I love polysaturated, too many partners. Yeah. I'm sure you've seen the t-shirt before, but I love the creativity, but also the playfulness around language in open non-monogamy. So I guess that was just an overview of kind of a different set of questions that maybe everyone can be asking about their relationships, thinking about where they're situated on those kind of continuums of emotional, sexual closeness, thinking about whether they like contracts or not, how much disclosure and privacy, how enmeshed relationships they want them to be, the relationship escalator, and then the words and the language they're using to describe their experiences and whether they need to develop further language to make sense of it. And I think those questions are worth encouraging people to ask on all kinds of relationships. So again, it's sad when I do training on non-monogamy for relationship therapists, you often get very little turnout. And I'm trying to say, look, this is useful for everybody. This is the kind of thing that's going to really help with your monogamous clients as well. It's not just about people in open non-monogamous relationships. And besides, most of your monogamous clients are probably having, you know, infidelities and affairs. They probably are dealing with exactly this stuff, or wanting to, or dealing with those tensions about whether online cyber sex and online porn counts or doesn't count, etc. But I just want to leave you with this, some additional thoughts about the word open, really, and whether expanding out that word might be another helpful set of questions to ask. And this is a blog I wrote recently, so if you want to read the kind of detail of it, you can have a look at that. I suppose I'm saying that the danger with open non-monogamy is it can end up falling to some of the similar traps that monogamy can also fall into, and of course neither of them have to, but they can fall into a kind of placing of one person or one relationship above all others, and some of the risks that has of the way that the additional people or the additional relationships get treated. And also this search for a relationship or a relationship structure that's going to make everything right, everything safe, everything perfect, which is quite a fear-based kind of mentality of seeking relationships. And again, I think Franklin Vo's memoir is really useful for those who haven't read it yet to explore that kind of, the way that searching for safety can really kind of constrain people in whatever kind of relationship. So if we think about different possible meanings of the word open, then we can maybe focus more on the how of relationships than the what. So again, away from that what people are doing, are they monogamous, are they non-monogamous, what kind of non-monogamous, to how are people living their relationships? Or it ain't what you do, it's the way that you do it. If people are familiar with 80s pop tunes, that's another way to to explain it. So openness could be about openness to vulnerability, kind of a move away from a fear-based mode of relating, a trying to make everything safe, to a more openness to being vulnerable, to things being scary, as they inevitably will be at times. And I looked at the research on relationship conflict for this, because research on relationship conflict says we tend to respond in one of two ways. We either withdraw during relationship conflict or we lash out at the other person. And there's some nice literature, particularly from Buddhist mindfulness, which is a philosophy I'm drawing on a lot, about what's the third way. You know, if you're not going to withdraw into yourself and shut down, and you're not going to lash out and blame someone else, can you kind of sit with that uncertainty, that kind of middle place of being basically open to vulnerability? And it's about learning how to stay with difficult feelings like jealousy, like fear, and be with them rather than just trying to shut them off, which is the more fear-based mode of relating. So I think there's some real value in trying to look for different ways of doing the emotional aspects of relationships. And again, I think that a lot of people who've been doing open non-monogamy have a lot to teach about how one might do that kind of thing. We could think about openness in terms of opening the windows on our relationships. So again, if you turn to kind of the literature on domestic abuse, you know, a lot of the problems around that is to do with the secrecy and the privacy around romantic relationships. So we particularly have the idea that we shouldn't tell people when we're struggling in romantic relationships. And I think culturally also there's a norm that we don't let people into the sexual side. And it was a real criticism that we had of the 50 Shades of Grey books and movies, right? Was kind of Christian was telling Anna, you mustn't talk to anyone about the kink side of things that we're doing because we've got to keep that secret. So I think we could think about openness in terms of the value of letting the air flow through relationships of all kinds more, so that we might get more of a sense from others of like, not sure about this, maybe this power dynamic is a bit troubling, you know, rather than people keeping their relationships very secret and not getting that sense of how they're appearing to others or being able to sort of look at them reflexively. And finally, opening our possibilities. Going back to Simone de Beauvoir and Jean-Paul Sartre, when they were thinking about, you know, is it possible to have a relationship where we're not trying to objectify the other person to be something for us, and we're not trying to make ourselves into something for the other person, but there's some kind of mutual arrangement. And they were pretty skeptical about whether this was possible, but by the end of both of their careers, they seemed to think that maybe we could get to something like that. You know, maybe that's a good way of evaluating relationships is in terms of how open they are for the people in it. How much do the people in it feel that they're mutually supportive and that they're able to kind of expand their possibilities, or how much are they feeling quite restricted by that relationship? Which comes into kind of treating ourselves and others consensually. And I'm really happy to see quite a bit on consent in this conference. I think Pepper's going to talk somewhat about power and consent, or I know you do talk about that in your writing. And Hannah and myself are going to do a workshop around consent in relationships as well. So just, you know, three ideas about if we didn't focus on openness just about are we open to non-monogamy, we might expand it out to think about openness to vulnerability, are the windows on our relationships open of all kinds of relationships, and how open are our possibilities in relationships. And I think from the relationship anarchy movement, it's really useful to start applying this way beyond just romantic relationships. So applying it also to our relationships with friends and colleagues. And I know that for me, thinking about Polly in terms of my writing relationships has been really helpful, and like how much I enjoy writing with different people and what comes out. And like, you know, just keeping it restricted to sexual relationships seems a bit of a shame. But then beyond humans, what about our relationships with companion animals? What about our relationships with work? You know, I love that bit in the Alison Bechdel comics where Sydney realizes work is her primary relationship. Does that strike a chord with anyone here? So, you know, expanding out to think about, yeah, how our relationship with places, our relationship with the world and the environment, for example. And this is just some of the relationship anarchy ideas from one of the websites, but there's plenty of other information online about that. So I think I will leave it there. That's just a few of the books I've mentioned over the course of the talk. And I'm handing over, am I handing over to Christina, or are we having questions? Is it? Great. Thank you very much.
Would you be terribly upset if I just sat there? Because this feels, yeah? Good. Thank you very much for not giving up and stay put, because there's a problem with the mic. Here we are. Okay, it's too loud. Okay, can we start by agreeing that we started a bit late? So it's very reasonable to think we're going to finish a quarter past the hour, okay? Is that cool with everyone, yeah? Okay, so I want to start by letting you know that for this presentation, I will be drawing heavily on a paper I gave in this absolutely amazing conference, which happened in June, called Queer Kinship and Relationships Conference in Poland, organized by my two wonderful colleagues and friends, Joanna Mielinska and Agata, who I love to bits, but keep forgetting the surname. They're sitting just there. So say hi. So this is the moment when I let you know there's at least four people in the room who attended that conference, that it is okay to check your Facebook or to leave for the next half an hour, okay? So, normalizing the slut, drawing a little bit on you apparently. Care is a particularly loaded notion. The cultural meanings attached to care cannot be disentangled from the context in which care emerged in the concerns of researchers, social workers, politicians, and other decision makers. Care can be generally described as domestic-based provision of unpaid services to vulnerable individuals vis-a-vis a retracting welfare and an increasingly aggressive market-oriented ethos that creates more and more vulnerability. In order to grasp its implications, we should add to this description the unsaid threat,
disguised as altruistic good practice, taking care in order to be cared for, fed by Judeo-Christian ideology and a charitable lending hand. We do to others as we hope to receive in an abstract and foreseen future. So care emerges not as a right or a guarantee of citizenship, dignity, and well-being, but rather as a voluntary and selfish assistance or help. But care is loaded in at least two other important ways. First, it points towards an involuntary or not objectification of the person in need of care. One takes care of children. One takes care of pets. And indeed, care comes into the picture as a consequence of situations of distress, disease, accident, weakness, deterioration. Care is a reaction to something negative and unexpected, something that causes insufficiency. In a culture which highly values autonomy and independent living, being an adult who is cared for deprives oneself from a sense of self-sufficiency and agency. Of course, autonomy is overrated. No one is fully 100% autonomous or independent. And in this regard, William's suggestion of redefining the concept of autonomy to fit with the notion of interdependence seems crucial. However, the dominant, that is, market-oriented, tale of success is not easily compatible with the recognition that we are mutually dependent and that we fail. The second ground on which care is a particularly loaded notion is gender. Care is gender loaded. Historically, women have been the agents of care provision within the family, providing direct support to children, the elderly, the other dependent family members. Many of the tasks related to the daily responsibilities of care have always been performed by women within the male breadwinner model. As unpaid labor, care provision in the domestic sphere is seen as a natural extension of the duties that are attached to the female role. Early critical accounts of care have provided an in-depth analysis of the gendering of care and how it became entangled with women's morality and a source of gender oppression. Even more recent discussions run the risk of reinforcing such morality by focusing exclusively on the ethics of care and the correspondent identity essentialism based on gender. So, to reiterate, care lends itself to a perspective that strives on power asymmetry. Moreover, it is presented as a moral duty, a responsibility with strict roles and expectations that replicate a patriarchal heteronormativity. Therefore, in this very brief incursion, we already recognize several of the difficulties in addressing care as a positive aspect of a gender-fair citizenship regime. And then came feminist and queer readings of care, turning this paradigm upside down, providing an alternative analysis through which care can be portrayed as both a public good and a potentially emancipatory personal device. Care for pleasure, care as attentive action, etc. Care as resistance, transgressive caregiving, etc. By looking at the margins of traditional subjects of care provision, shifting away from the dominant white, reproductive, married, heterosexual couple, a whole range of care practices became visible, hence thinkable. As Kessler puts it, when care is practiced outside the traditional family, it can be deeply subversive of gender, race, class, and sexuality norms. By ascribing analytical value to the margins of care provision, academia fulfills one of its most challenging and important tasks, providing social and politically relevant tools that contribute to transforming ways of thinking, doing, and enacting. Of course, a group which has been at the margins of theoretical thought and social policy around care provision is LGBTQ polyamorous people. But before getting into the implications of poly to rethinking care and citizenship, let me take you on a brief tour about beginnings, belongings, and starting points. So where to start? Contrary to the most resilient cultural expectations throughout the days we have known, our intimate biographies are anything but linear, anything but extraordinary and peculiar. All it takes is to speak to therapists and sex workers, two of the professions which gather more knowledge about the range of human experience that any expert in sociology of family might dream of. Each story is different. There is never a starting point, a unique reason to justify why and how we are at this particular situation instead of a different one. Still, we search for a reason. We produce narratives, intimate, personal life stories that strive to account for who we are today. This is precisely what we at the Intimate Research Project have been asking a series of people to do. So we start with this question. As you know, I'm interested in intimate relationships. Please tell me the story of your life, all the events and experiences that have been important to you personally. You can start wherever you want. Take as long as you need. I will not interrupt. So we ask people, self-identified lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer people of all sorts, ages between 25 and 45, living in Lisbon, Madrid, or Rome, to trust us with their stories. Whatever comes to mind, whatever they feel is important to them personally. And in this exercise, different people do different things. Some start by telling us the first time they fell in love, or the first time they had a long-term relationship. Some start from now, or from the first time they had sex, or they cohabited with a partner. For some, time travel as far as memory can stretch. Others gather memories according to themes, lovers, friends, platonic relationships, cats, or job. Others organize their story around turning points, before coming out, after coming out, before transitioning, after transitioning. But the point is, even when we all fail to acknowledge it, each of our interviewees started from the beginning. The beginning is not a fixed, tidy category. The beginning is not necessarily attached to a list of items arranged in chronological order. The beginning of their story is what each of them decided to speak first. If we are to discuss sex, love, intimate biographies, the beginning cannot be anything but self-perceived. And random and extraordinary, as original as fingerprints. So before getting into the gist of what I prepared for you today, let me briefly take you on a tour that highlights two of the starting points, two biographical triggers of this talk. These biographical notes are important because we do not just produce knowledge. We make choices based on research interests and more on an array of constraints that include cuts and fears about not getting funded or failing to achieve a certain status or respect from our peers who think we are perhaps a tad too politicized, a bit too angry, a killjoy, as Sarah Ahmed explained it better than anyone before her. So as situated researchers, it seems wise to explain what the situation was before we got here. Trigger one, a trip to the museum. So perhaps surprisingly, our tour starts at the Museum of the History of Polish Jews, Polin, recently launched in Warsaw. The trigger there was an all-time favorite, which I was poignantly reminded of as I entered the main exhibition of this impressive museum in June. A sentence on the wall read, "Build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit, take wives and beg at sons and daughters." So this pretty much sums it up. It encapsulates what is it that, as we grow old to become proper adults, are expected to do. Find a place to live, presumably after getting a job. Find food to put in your plate. Mate, cohabit, reproduce. This is the most resilient and powerful relational script. You do this, and you do it by following this particular order. Mate, cohabit, reproduce. Hold that in your head, okay? As if you didn't know before me. Trigger two. This takes us to another stop in this tour. The UK, 10 years ago, where I got my PhD degree in gender studies at University of Leeds and worked for several years in an amazing international research project called FemCit, Gendered Citizenship in Multicultural Europe, coordinated by Sasha Rosnil. Funded by the European Commission during 4 years, FemCit was a rather ambitious and fantastic project that gathered 69 researchers throughout Europe. I was responsible for the study on intimate citizenship and the impact of women's movements in Portugal. FemCit was officially over in 2011, But the thing with large studies is that they tend to perpetuate far beyond our wildest dreams and energies. So in 2013, together with colleagues from FEMSIT, we co-edited a special issue of the journal Citizenship Studies. It was called Reproduction and Citizenship / Reproducing Citizens. The main argument behind the idea for submitting it as a proposal was our perception that there are certain rules attached to this fantasy around adulthood. One of them is the procreative norm. The procreative norm describes the assumption, expectation, and cultural demand that biological procreation should occupy the center ground of the social formation, that intimate relationships, sexuality, and the wider organization of social should be driven by and structured around a naturalized notion of a primary, fundamental, procreative imperative. So we consider how the state and mainstream culture was encouraging good citizens to have children, basically. But the procreative norm is not alone. And in fact, we are just finishing the manuscript of a co-authored book on another of these rules, what we framed as the couple norm, that is the cultural expectation that when one becomes an adult should not remain single, and parallel to this, the social and legal validation that stems from the marital status when it is deemed as acceptable, adequate marital status. Okay? And this leads us straight into the main point of this talk, not about the pressure to be heterosexually partnered so much, but most of all about the pressure to be a committedly monogamous partner, a monogamy wrestler, if you will. So intimate, citizenship, care and choice, the micropolitics of intimacy in Southern Europe, is a large cross-national multidisciplinary research project funded by the European Research Council for 5 years. And I will not dwell too much on the project because we will have a whole panel presentation drawing on results of the project Sunday morning, so I'm advertising for that for those of you who are interested. So it's conducted at the Center for Social Studies. It's comparative between Italy, Portugal, and Spain. And it's based on three strands. We're going to pass that. Partnering, which is the one we're conducting at the moment, with two studies within that, one on lesbian coupledom and one on poly. Next year it will be on parenting, with two studies again, queering reproduction and the politics of naming a child. We can speak a bit about this later. And then in 2017, 2018, we'll be focusing on friendship. Again, two studies, networks of care between and by trans people and cohabiting with friends. We don't do anything on our own, so I'm lucky to have and privileged and super happy to have a wonderful, wonderful team who is here. And there's only one person whose picture is missing because the internet connection crashed at the hotel last night. It was Mafalda Esteves there. And also we have international consultants with us, and we benefit hugely from their presence and input. So, okay. Within the intimate project, we consider polyamorous relationships in its potential to offer new understandings of doing relationships and challenging the heteronormative constraints of mainstream coupledom. For pragmatic reasons, to us, in intimate project, polyamory became to a great extent a catchword to include people who engaged in intimate relationships with more than one person with the knowledge of everyone involved in the relationship. Okay, so being aware of the political and theoretical implications of using polyamory, we decided to retain the use of this notion based on the increasing mainstreaming of the word in the media and popular culture in the countries involved in the study, that is Portugal, Spain, and Italy. More and more people know what poly means, even if they are not aware of its specificities. People who have heard of polyamory know it is different from swing practices or occasional sex encounters, fuck buddies, etc. So to us, polyamory sets people's minds into the mode of relationship and all the things that are culturally attached to the imaginary around doing intimate relationships. Aspects related to care, commitment, support, negotiation, responsibility, attachment, length. I invite you to retain some of these words and link them to how we started this talk. Care, commitment, attachment. All of which is de- and reconstructed and constructed through polyamory, but always in response and deeply influenced by the dominant relational script: mate, cohabit, reproduce. This is where the politics of normalization that we know from the queer critique of same-sex marriage and before that enter into the realm of non-monogamy. Participants in the intimate study got the usual questions when they came out as poly. What about children? What about when you get old? This is a phase, right? And more. And with that set of questions and unspoken suspicion comes the need to explain, to create and rehearse a narrative, a persuasive one, aiming at tidying it up so well that not even you believe in it, but it is designed to calm down social panic around non-monogamy. And so the rehearsed narrative very often evolves around love, romantic, responsible, committed, caring love. A large family home for the constellation and polyparenting are perhaps two of the most visible aspects of a narrative of respectability that supports demands for social recognition. These arguments echo Michael Warner's earlier writings about shame, dignity, and sexual politics. If you recall, he contends that the LGBT movement is trying to clean itself, and that cleanliness, is, in this sense, is equivalent to desexualizing politics in order to transform it into something that you could take home to mom. Drawing on Warner's work, Richardson argues that there is a shift in the cultural meanings attached to being lesbian or gay, which is increasingly constructed as a social rather than a sexual category. This shift translates itself into normative focus on the desirability and necessity of marital-style sexual coupledom. And here I was quoting Richardson. These changes contribute to the creation and recognition of the normal gay, who, according to Stephen Seidman, is expected to be gender conventional, link sex to love and a marriage-like relationship, defend family values, personify economic individualism, and display national pride, end of quote. When in fact is much messier than that and richer than that. It is experimental, yes, in the sense that for each person it will be different and extraordinary. So as politically engaged queer researchers, as we are, we need to contribute to reverse the dominant paradigm through which issues of care and relationships are being addressed. When it comes to intimate biographies, including non-monogamous intimate biographies, there is much more experimentation and chaos than rules and scripts. The word desire, and not necessarily simply sexual desire, seems more significant in people's intimate stories than the word commitment. Pleasure, more liberating than formal duty. Self-esteem, at least as urgent as legal recognition of polymarriage, in case we want to go down that road. Most of all, we need to find room to retain the slut, rather than erasing it under the figure of the well-behaved intimate citizen who happens to be non-monogamous, but who nonetheless plays by the relational script book: mate, cohabit, reproduce. That said, so this is one part of the thing I really wanted to share with you, but I also want to retain another side to this, okay? So that said, it is probably too late to reject equality claims altogether based on a simplistic critique to assimilationism. People outside our cozy bubble understand that all people are equal under the law, and yes, under the eyes of God. They have more trouble in understanding that some of us do not really care about the sort of equality they have to offer. And quite frankly, most of the people we care about are not politically committed into turning all tables upside down, rejecting any form of social or legal recognition, rising above whatever we deem as not subversive enough. Therefore, as activists or academics engaged in intimate citizenship, we need to work from common ground to focus on aspects which put us on the same page, even when it's hard because each page is different. We need notions such as care, citizenship, belonging, as we need desire, pleasure, self-esteem. And to bring them together as relevant variables when reframing law and social policy, which is at the core of how we construct our intimate biographies. So maybe we need to start from what average LGBTIQ people are saying and doing, how intimacy is constructed and managed on a daily basis, and what does practice say about what is missing from literature and social policy. So instead of ditching the notions of care or citizenship, including intimate citizenship, maybe we can continue the never-ending task of pushing its boundaries in ways which are not about inventing the wheel, but rather simply acknowledging how mainstream understandings of these notions do not tell the whole story. And this is where relational citizenship may become handy. Shaped by significant developments regarding sexual and reproductive citizenship, the complex arrangements to do with care and choice in the context of non-monogamy push decision makers, theorists included, to change the ways in which citizenship is framed and enacted by law, social policy, and social cultural outlets. So therefore, in Intimate, we are suggesting the notion of non-monogamous relational citizenship to capture both the disjunctions and possibilities for reframing how we perceive, represent, and manage our intimate lives. And we are identifying three levels, and this is pretty much ongoing, okay? Work in progress, that's what I mean. So relational citizenship is self-perceived to mean being partnered, self-identifying as non-single, or being in a relationship. Also, relational citizenship as a representational system in the context of public institutions, when you renew your ID card or register your child in school, etc., but also in the context of family. Several people mentioned in the study how it was harder to them to come out as poly to their families than it was to come out as lesbian or gay, etc. Also, things to do with family ceremonies or funerals or Christmas dinners, whatever, weddings. And also relational citizenship and daily management of intimacy. More care. To care about, to be cared for, to extend care. Who's in, who's out, what it means to be in or out. So relational citizenship describes the ways in which we self-perceive and are represented by others as being partnered. Relational citizenship is about belonging. It aims at addressing questions of identity and social validation, cultural norms and expectations, opportunities and obstacles that stems from the relational status of each individual. It includes significant relationships, intimate, but not necessarily sexual or romantic. It can include cohabitation or not. Relational citizenship highlights the immense diversity in the way we construct our intimate biographies. There is no protocol, no guidelines, no formula, no relational script. Most of the time, we do as we go along. People start in different and equally extraordinary places. So, to conclude, care can mean to watch over, to look after, to assist in practical ways, as well as to feel attachment and fondness. And here I was quoting Jamieson. Against the backdrop of heteronormative law and social policy, there is a range of care practices which are particularly crucial in a context of economic crisis when the welfare state fails to provide adequate support. In southern European countries, the importance of a strong welfare society that compensates for the shortcomings of state provision has been identified. So if we are to reframe the paradigm of care rather than rejecting it, questions we need to pose ourselves include the following. How relevant is the framework of care to think about LGBTIQ experiences in Italy, Portugal, and Spain? Based on current experiences in Southern Europe, to what extent can we think of care as a positive, transgressive experience? What specific challenges and opportunities are posed by polyamory relationships to the current paradigm of care provision? And how can poly-intimate biographies contribute to rethinking care and citizenship? A similar exercise can be suggested about the notion of citizenship. Gradually, the notion of citizenship is being pushed and stretched to include demands that have been previously left out. Post-structuralist contributions to citizenship theory have advanced the understandings of citizenship as highly contingent, fragmented, dynamic. Today, it is argued that citizenship can be understood both as an academic and political concept and as lived experience. In such context, it seems important to consider the mutual implications of intimacy and citizenship, exploring the extent to which issues of partnering, parenting, and friendship are important aspects of being and becoming recognized as a citizen. Given this challenge, the intention is to move beyond the theoretical dispute between intimate and sexual citizenship in order to advance reciprocal ways in which these and other perspectives on citizenship can and should contribute to the politics and practices of intimacy in everyday life. The notion of relational citizenship based on the intimate biographies of everyday LGBTIQ polyamorous people may be an important step towards reframing care, choice, and the uniqueness of each extraordinary individual story, including the slutty one who resists a normalizing relational script. So before showing you the last slides, I want us to watch and listen to a video, okay? And to pay attention to the lyrics as well as we go along.
She was home, she was a swan. When she was out, she was a tiger. And a tiger in the wild is not tied to anyone. When she was lost, she was a toad. The day found her on the road, I gave her water and a rose. And as she stretched, the sun rose. go, go away, go away.
One last minute. I don't want to do the boring stuff, which is to draw lessons on something which is moving and emotional to a lot of us, but just to highlight two or three sentences of what the song says. At some point she says, when she was out, she was a tiger, and the tiger in the wild is not tied to anyone. And she also says, women to survive must be unfaithful to their child. And I suppose this is important to me, and I thought it would be relevant to bring it also to this conference, because it's about the extraordinariness of each story and the importance of retaining the self, including the slutty one, and not falling into the trap of becoming a good behaved citizen if one doesn't desire to do so. And I think this is this couldn't be more relevant in the times we're living now. Okay, so 30 seconds to say that you need to save the dates. Okay, so we'll be organizing the first intimate conference on the 30th and 31st of March. It will be called Queering Partnering, and it will be held in Coimbra. The call for papers will be issued very soon, but for now, what you do is you save the date. Okay, and there will also be a summer school in the summer. And while you are checking your Facebook profile, don't forget to follow us also. That we're not on Twitter, we don't do everything, but we do have a very nice Facebook page with more than 1,000 people, so do join us. And thank you very much for your attention here. Yeah?